Jesus Christ has always been the plan of God, the Word, the Logos. That has been true since before time began. But the coming of our Savior, with his victory on the cross, with his resurrection and glorification, and with the gift of the Spirit he was granted to bequeath us thereby, all things have become new. Revelation 21:5 and Galatians 6:15. Failing to take advantage of that newness in the Spirit was a terrible missed opportunity. Turning back to the old, which had been replaced, was compromising the Jerusalem church to its core, a failure to recognize the times of the new dispensation of Christ's church, which hearkened back to a similar failure to recognize the Messiah in an earlier generation. As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, Jesus wept over it and said, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you." Luke 19:41-44. This prophecy was only a few years from coming to fulfillment when the believers in Jerusalem received this letter. How they would fare, individually and collectively, would have much to do with their response. Christ the Logos. To boil things down to their essentials, the Jerusalem church was failing, where believers who are backsliding or stagnating or feeling dry or otherwise falling short always fail. They lost their focus on and their commitment to Jesus Christ. While they still gave him lip service, in their hearts they had not treasured him as the one of most importance in their lives, a failure common enough in our own day, resulting from many causes and manifesting itself in a variety of negative ways. For the Jerusalem church, the main cause was the combination of persecution coupled with lukewarmness to the truth, the net effect of which was turning away from the Lord, which led them back to the law and, or turning back to the law, which led away from the Lord. Whichever was the chicken and whichever was the egg, the end result was the same, losing touch with him who is the head of the church, Colossians 2:18 and 19, and drifting away from the one who is our very life, Jesus Christ, our dear Lord and Savior. For this reason, that is, the infinite superiority of Christ, the Logos over angels, as the God-man who has won the victory of the entire plan of God, it is all the more necessary for us to pay attention to the teachings we have heard, lest we drift away off course. For if the word, Greek, Logos, that is, the law which is in its essence about the Logos, spoken through angels was confirmed, and every violation of it received its appropriate recompense, then how shall we flee the consequences of having neglected our so great salvation? For it is this very salvation, which, having received its initial expression through the Lord by those who heard him, that is, in the early days of the church, has now been confirmed to us in the present day through God, the Father himself, bearing witness to it through signs and wonders and various other demonstrations of his power, and with distributions of the Holy Spirit, that is, spiritual gifts, according to his will. Hebrews 2:1-4. The teachings referred to by Paul here are the ones of which his readers had just been reminded in chapter 1, namely, the essential doctrines about the deity and humanity of Jesus Christ and his centrality in the plan of God as being the Word, the Logos, the very plan of God itself as the one upon whom it is based and in whom alone it is fulfilled, John 1:1-14. He, that is Jesus Christ, is the exact image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. Everything in the heavens and on the earth was created by him, things invisible as well as those visible, whether thrones, authorities, rulers or powers, everything was created through him and for him. And he himself is before everything, and everything subsists in him. Colossians 1:15-17. But for us, there is but one God, the Father from whom all things have come into being, that is, the Father as architect of creation, and we now live for him, and there is but one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom all things have come into being, that is, the Son as agent of creation, and we now live through him. 1 Corinthians 8:6. This backsliding was inevitable in returning to the rituals of the law, since the law was already fulfilled by Jesus Christ, making all of its prior symbolism null and void, and thus rendering any further allegiance to it by believers mere traditional rote, a practice which not only produced spiritual decline by its own agency, but also left these believers vulnerable to Gnostic appeals, as they soon found themselves completely spiritually dry through having rejected the water of the Word and the power of it in the Spirit, John 7, 38 and 39. Having lost contact with the head, Colossians 2, 18 and 19, these believers were floundering spiritually as a result, and had thus left themselves open to cheap substitutes for the truth of which Gnosticism, with its eclectic false teachings, was the devil's main contemporary ploy. Since both problems, that is, legalism and Gnosticism, were at their core problems of perverting the precious truths about Jesus Christ into satanic lies, the two often blended seamlessly into one heretical tableau, with the one leading to the other. The true Logos, Jesus Christ, is God as well as man, undiminished deity and true humanity in one perfect person forever since the Incarnation. This essential truth was uncompromisingly contrary to the Pharisaical legalism of the day, which was hostile to the idea of the Messiah being true God who had taken on human form. It was also uncompromisingly contrary to the Gnostic notion of the Messiah being some sort of super-angel, semi-divinity who was not material. But only the God-man Jesus Christ could ever have redeemed us from our sins. This, and many other critical teachings about our Savior, had slipped from the hearts of many, if not most of the members of this community of erstwhile believers, without a doubt as a result not only of persecution, but also as a result of a general lackadaisical attitude to the teaching of the truth of Scripture and to the teaching of it on the part of those responsible for doing so. Cease listening to instruction, my son, and you will stray from the words of knowledge. Proverbs 19:27. This is a good warning for us all to internalize. No matter how far ahead we have progressed, no matter how much we have learned, no matter how close to the Lord we have drawn through the truth, James 4:8. If we are not going forward, we will most likely soon be headed backward, and slipping back down the hill we have just climbed is not only easier than going up it, it is also a quicker process, as the Jerusalem believers demonstrate. Jesus Christ is the plan of God, through which the Father provides judgment, restoration, and replacement of all that was lost through Satan's revolt on the basis of the sacrifice of our Lord on the cross. As the one who carries out the plan, Greek, Logos, Jesus Christ is himself the Word, Greek, Logos, of God, the embodiment of the Father's message, the Father's plan, the incarnate Logos, the living Word of God. The Word Jesus Christ existed at the very beginning, and there was reciprocity, that is, co-divinity, between the Word and God, the Father. And the Word was God. John 1:1. What we have seen from the beginning, what we have heard and seen with our eyes, what we have observed and touched with our hands, this is about the Word of life, Jesus Christ. 1 John 1:1. And he was clothed in a cloak splattered with blood, and his name stands forever, the Word of God. Revelation 19:13. Jesus Christ is the message, the messenger, and the one who implements the message by empowering it at the cross and by administering it throughout human history, doing so in person at the two Advents. All divine revelation of the past pointed through shadows to his coming and to the cross. All divine revelation since his resurrection, ascension, session, glorification, and sending of the Spirit harkens back to who he is and what he has accomplished for us, even as it looks forward to our blessed hope of his return, Titus 2:13. These truths should be obvious to any Bible-reading believer, and certainly to any believer who is sitting under even passably acceptable Bible teaching. But the Jerusalem believers had lost sight of the centrality of Jesus Christ to the detriment of all they had once believed and even suffered for. Instead of persevering, they were in grave danger of falling away completely. Hebrews 10:32-37. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Hebrews 3:12.